In Fusion 360, creating a custom machine configuration will automate your workflow and help ensure your CAM setup is correct every time. I'll walk you through the steps to create a configuration for hobbyist machines, such as the Shapeoko, X-Carve, and LongMill. We'll first need to head to the Manufacture workspace by selecting it from the Workspace's drop-down list. Then, activate the Machine Library, which houses many pre-made machine configurations, as well as any custom machines that you previously set up. The Machine Library can be activated from the toolbar, the Manage drop-down, or by creating a new setup followed by the machine selector. The left dialog pane lists the available libraries. Let's select the Fusion 360 library. This sample library includes all the standard machines that come with Fusion 360. Notice the list of machines that now appear in the center of the dialog. On the right, we can filter the machine results by capability types. For this demo, I'm going to reference my CNC mill, which is the LongMill Benchtop CNC. I'll start by selecting the milling filter. Most of the machines in the Fusion 360 library are commercial-level machines. However, you'll see that Autodesk has also included generic machine configurations. These are a great starting point for hobbyist machines, and we can leverage these to set up our custom machine. It's important to note that we cannot edit machines listed in the Fusion 360 library unless we first create a copy. The LongMill CNC is a three-axis machine, so I'll start by selecting the Autodesk generic three-axis. Once selected, we can either right-click and select Copy, or select Copy at the top of the dialog. We'll then need to decide which library to paste the machine in. The local library contains machines that are stored locally on your computer. Meanwhile, linked allows you to select or link to a specific folder on your computer. This could be a cloud-based folder so you can access your machines from anywhere. Note that you can also create additional library folders if needed. For now, I'll simply select the local folder. We can either right-click on the folder or in the center of the dialog, followed by the paste option. Throughout this process, you'll also find all the icons at the top of the dialog. Now that we've created a copy, we're able to edit the machine to our desired specifications. Simply right-click on the machine and select Edit. We'll want to work our way through each tab of the dialog. The accuracy of this information is critical in making sure your machine operates properly. The description options will display in the machine library to help you identify your machine. These do not affect any of the post-processing or the setup of your machine. I'll type in LongMill Benchtop CNC for the description. For model, I'll put 30 by 30, which is the size that I purchased. The vendor or company name is CNC. And lastly, the CNC control is the package of electronics and software that take input from the G-code or a control panel and convert it into signals that the machine uses to move. The LongMill uses a custom controller called the Longboard. I'll type that out here. If you're not sure what your controller is, you can simply skip this step. Many hobbyist machines use a microcontroller, such as the Arduino. We can now head to the Dimensions tab. This represents the footprint of the machine or the area the machine occupies. This does not represent the cutting area. The machine footprint of the LongMill is approximately 45 inches by 44 inches. Notice the inputs are in millimeters. You can switch the unit of measure at the bottom of the dialog. I'll then type out 45 inches for the width, 15 inches for the height, and 44 inches for the depth. I'm not familiar with the weight of the machine, so I'll leave that set to 0 pounds. Moving on to the Capabilities tab, it's here that we'll define the type of machine and some of its functions. These are very important for producing valid G-code for your machine, as this information is shared with the post-processor to alter the output. Most hobbyist machines, including mine, will only do milling. If that's the case, double-check that milling is the only thing checked. The LongMill and most hobbyist machines do not have automatic tool changers, so we can uncheck these two options and ignore the others in this section. Lastly, we have the option to define the maximum feeds and speeds for the machine. This will help prevent the machine from going faster than the manufacturer recommendations. Note that these can also be defined in individual cam setups or tool paths. With that in mind, I'll leave these set to zero for now. The workpiece is where we define the maximum sized part that will fit on the machine. The LongMill has a cutting area of 31 by 33 inches by 4.4 inches in the Z height. This is a benchtop CNC, so the weight capacity could be set to the weight capacity of the workbench, or we can simply leave this set to zero. The Kinematics tab includes how the machine is assembled, including how the axes stack on each other. Note that this section allows you to add and restructure the nesting of these axes. For example, we want to make sure that our spindle is nested under the Z axis. We also want the table to be on the same level as the machine or the base kinematics. We can drag and drop these as needed. Within each subset, we can then define the minimum and maximum range, rapid and max feed rates, as well as other settings per each subset. It's helpful to fill out as much information as you know. However, this may vary based on your post-processor and how it uses this information. For now, I'll leave this as is, and let's move on to the machining time. This tab includes factors used to calculate the cycle times or how long the machine will be running. First is the feed rate ratio, which is used to adjust for inaccuracies in calculating cycling time. It's recommended to leave this at 100%. Meanwhile, the tool change cycle time can be changed to the actual time it takes you to change your tool. However, with hobbyist machines, this will depend on how you approach your manual tool change. Do you post everything at once or run each tool path separately? I simply changed this to zero, as I often post the tool paths individually. The coolant tab includes many coolant types that are available on CNC machines. The majority of hobbyist machines do not offer coolant, so be sure to uncheck this option if yours does not. The post-processing tab is arguably the most important. It's here that we'll select the post-processor that interprets our toolpath information and converts it into code that our CNC machine can read. A lot of hobbyist machines use the open-source post-processor pronounced Gerbil, which is written as GRBL. However, be sure to check with your machine manufacturer, as you must select the correct option. You can also define the default post folder. By default, any code you post will be placed in the NC folder, which was included in your Fusion 360 download. I like to set mine to the desktop or downloads folder, so new toolpaths are easily accessible. Last but not least, you will see a multi-axis tab. This pertains to CNCs that have more than three axes, so we can go ahead and ignore this altogether. We can now click OK to save this machine configuration. Taking approximately 10 minutes to set up your machine configuration will save you a ton of time in the future. I can now select my LongMill CNC each time I create a new setup in Fusion 360's manufacturer workspace. Take note of the machine dimensions and information on the right pane of the dialog. It's a good idea to double check this info, including your post-processor. Lastly, you may find it helpful to share a machine configuration with a friend or colleague. To do so, simply select the machine, followed by the export icon at the top of the dialog. You can then choose the name and location before saving the .machine file. At any time, you can import a .machine file right here in the dialog. To summarize, now that we've created a reusable machine configuration, we can simply choose it each time we create a cam setup, which will automatically pre-populate a number of fields that affect our G-code. Taking the time to create your machine in Fusion 360 will not only save you time, but ensure that you're working with a consistent setup each time. If you're interested in learning Fusion 360 CAM, be sure to check out our courses at productdesignonline.com. Last but not least, special thanks to all the new patrons and supporters who have bought me coffee over the last couple weeks. Be sure to subscribe for more Fusion 360 CAM tutorials right here on YouTube.